Good afternoon, everybody. This is the fifth lecture. And there is light at the end of the tunnel. Tomorrow will be the last lecture. So you can heave a sigh of relief. All right? Okay. So let me spend about 2 minutes because it's a 5 minute gap. Sorry, 5 day gap. So many of you may not have reviewed. And second thing is that, Shweta, is there any flickering? If there is any flickering, please let me know.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Because the other day there was some flickering, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I don't have to spend too much time in recalling because I have only 2 days. Yeah. So we have a function f from a subset u of r2 to r and a be a point in u, then we define what is meant by differentiability. So we gave epsilon delta definition, then we interpreted that it is same as saying the first definition said f is differentiable at a b, that means f is approximately equal to the first degree polynomial some alpha times x minus a plus beta times y minus b for x, y near to a. In terms of epsilon delta, we formulated this carefully. And later we also said, whatever you get here, this is the equation of a plane. Passing through the point a, b, f of a, b. Okay, all right. So the notion of differentiability is equivalent to asking exists a plane passing through this point, which is very, as I drew the picture that day, at this point, it coincides and it's very approximately equal to the surface. This is the surface that equal to fxy. This is the plane given by this equation. Okay, and approximately equal to, what does it mean? If you are very near to the point AB, then the distance between the plane and the corresponding point on the surface, okay, the error you are making is very small. That is what the epsilon delta tells you. These are the two things we observed that day. The third thing we observed was the following. So that involved the notion of partial derivatives. So what did it say? So fix a point, the same notation. Then let us look at the map going to f of, let us say x comma b, where b is fixed. Okay, this is a function of one variable as long as xb is in this domain. Okay, this may be the domain of the function. This may be ab, okay. This is A, this is B. So as long as this, so that means it is going to vary here. Okay, this is Y equal to B, X, B will be like on this line. Okay, therefore you are restricting this function on this, but it's actually a one variable function. Therefore I can show that if F is differentiable, then this function, call it G sub B, because that fixed at B, therefore depends upon B. F is differentiable implies G suffix B is differentiable at what point? At AB. If it is differential at AB, this is differential at AB, and we know that G dash at B A, that is the derivative of this function at A, is nothing other than your alpha. And a similar thing we did was for HA. Y going to f of a comma a, y. Then we showed h dash at b is nothing other than beta. So as a corollary, what we found out was if f is differential at a b, the partial derivative, these are called the partial derivatives, because g of b, let us say g b dash at a is f of a plus h b minus h limit h goes to zero. Okay, so therefore you are allowing only the first variable. Therefore, that if the limit exists and that is denoted by partial derivative of f at the point AB. So if f is differentiable at AB, we showed that partial derivatives exist, and the alpha and beta are nothing other than the partial derivatives of f at the point A and B respectively. Okay, up to that we have seen in the last lecture. So it already took 4 minutes. Okay. Now there are few questions you one can ask. Okay. There is obvious question. Since in the definition of differentiability, if alpha and beta, if I say f is differentiable at AB, what does it mean? There exists real numbers alpha and beta such that something happens. So the first point is I have to assert the existence of alpha and beta. So it seems that is very easy. It is reduced to one variable problem, namely look at the partial derivative of f at the point AB, then call it alpha and beta respectively. You got this first degree polynomial. You understand that? If the partial derivatives exist, then I have the first degree polynomial without any doubt, no problem. But that may not show f is differentiable at the point AB, because it's not f is equal to this first degree polynomial, but also say it first degree polynomial approximates the function f very well. What do we mean by that? This is going to answer your question which you asked, one of you asked earlier. I said in the next lecture I will do that. That is, can somebody has unmuted the mic, please mute your mic. Okay, let us see. When I want to say f of xy is approximately equal to f of ab plus alpha times x minus a plus beta times y minus b, then the error, let me write it as only error. This error is f of xy minus this object, the first degree polynomial. Okay. This will depend upon x minus a and y minus b, or if you write x equal to a plus h and y equal to b plus k, so you can write it as either x minus a or y minus b or e of hk. What we wanted was e should go to zero faster than hk or x minus a, y minus b going to zero. This is the crucial word. Why I need faster? Why can't I say E goes to zero? Okay. Why can't I say E goes to zero as HK go to zero? Why can't I say this? Why do I have to say it goes faster? One of you asked this question. I said I will do it. And I want to do it in the third lecture itself. But I thought I will do it later. Okay. Why? Let us look at something. Suppose my function f from u to r is continuous at AB. You understand this? This is continuous at AB, right? Okay. Now, then let us assume alpha, let me take alpha equal to zero and beta also equal to zero. If I simply say this as a definition, okay, then I'm going to say f is differentiable at AB. You understand this? If you accept this as the definition, error goes to zero as fast as HK going to zero, then any continuous function will be differentiable at the point. Do you appreciate this? You know that mod x is not, this is continuous but not differentiable, because there is no unique tangent as I go along. From here, this will be the tangent. If I come along this, this is a tangent. Therefore, there is no tangent here. That means the derivative does not exist. So this is a continuous function, but it's not differentiable. So differentiability is a stronger notion. Now I'll prove that. Why? I have to show if it's differentiable at AB with this as the definition, which is wrong definition. Okay. If this is your definition, then I'm going to prove every continuous function is differentiable, because these are the things which textbooks do not explain. Okay, that is why I have to require it goes faster than the error, the increment going to zero. Let's do that. So let's look at that. A plus h minus b plus k minus f of a b minus my alpha is zero, zero times h minus zero times k. This is what I want to say. This goes to zero as hk go to zero. This is according to this wrong definition, right? But that is true, because this is same as saying f of a plus h b plus k minus f of a b, right? And since f is continuous at a b, as hk go to zero, this goes to zero. Do you follow that? How many of you appreciate this? So my requirement is this error should goes to zero faster than this. Please appreciate this. This is a crucial point. How many of you appreciate this point? Please say yes if you do that. Okay. So you see that such a simple looking definition, you can simply memorize, but then it's loaded with a lot of subtle meanings. Okay. It's like you're saying a very cryptic poem. Okay. You have to read again and again and again to understand what the poet tries to say. Okay. So it's not enough. It's like chanting like mantra. F is differential at AB if there is alpha and beta, blah, 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 blah. That's not going to help us. Okay. Next, I'm going to show if F is differentiable at AB, F is continuous at AB. Now we are back to our definition, okay? This wrong definition is discarded once and for all. Okay. This we are not going to look at. We will be back to our definition. That is also easy, because if f is differentiable at AB, what do I know? There exists alpha and beta such that something happens. So let me write it. A plus h, b plus k, minus f of AB, minus alpha times h, minus beta times k, is less than or equal to epsilon times square root of h squared plus k squared. Whenever zero less than h squared k squared less than delta squared. Okay, right. Now this inequality immediately implies f of a plus h b plus k minus f of a b is less than or equal to alpha mod alpha into mod h plus mod beta into mod k, right, plus epsilon into h squared plus k squared. Okay, this will be less than or equal to alpha plus mod beta plus epsilon times square root of h squared plus k squared, because mod h will be less than or equal to root of h squared plus k squared, and so is mod k. Therefore, I can combine all of them together, I get another inequality. So as hk go to zero, these are all fixed constants now, therefore this goes to zero as hk go to zero. This should f of a h b k goes to f of a b, that is same as saying continuity at a b. Okay, so please pause. I'll give you few seconds. So today what have we shown? I have shown, explain why the error term should go to zero faster than increment going to zero. Second, if f is differentiable at the point, then it is continuous at that point. These are the two things today we have proved new. Do you understand this? Please say yes. As I said, my requirements are very minimal. 30 to 40%. If you understand, that's good enough. because the rest has to come from you. You have to review. Okay, now let's go back to the first thing, what we did last time, which I did just today. If f is differentiable at a, b, then I said the partial derivative of f at x, partial derivative with respect to x at a, b, and similarly partial derivative of f with respect to y at the point a, b exist. And in the definition, as I said, I seem to know only those partial derivatives. Right. So what is the natural question you can ask? Can somebody tell me what is the natural question one can ask? Anybody in the audience? If f is differentiable, I will make it easy so that you know. Okay, it's a leading question. If f is differentiable at ab, the partial derivatives of f at a and at ab exist. What is the natural question you would like to ask? Come on. Somebody.
Sir, if partial derivative exists, then what can we say about the derivative?
Right, converse true. Right. So, if the partial derivatives exist at the point AB, can I conclude f is differentiable at AB? You understand this? Yeah. But as I said earlier, it's not only this all existence of alpha and beta, but the crucial condition, the error should go to zero faster than. Okay. That is the one which is going to be a spoil sport. What do I mean by that? I say that f may be such that the partial derivatives at the point a, b exist, but the function may not even be continuous. Therefore, it cannot be differentiable. You understand that? Because any differentiable function has to be continuous. Just now I proved it. Okay. So the answer converse. Okay. And it's false. Why? Let us look at this function we had already seen when we talked about limits. Okay. Then you can see at the point 0, 0, I want to say dou f by dou I, del f by del x, it exists and both are equal to 0. Okay, that's obvious because let's look at. So what is, I have to look at, this means I have to look at h comma 0 minus f of 0 0 by h. But notice that y equal to 0, therefore this numerator is already 0, h is not 0, therefore h squared plus 0 squared, that is h squared, therefore this is 0. F of 0 0 by definition is 0, therefore the numerator is always 0, therefore it converges to 0. That means the partial derivative of f with respect to x is 0. Similarly, the partial derivative of f with respect to y at the point 0, 0 is also 0, right? But you have seen the function is not continuous. Why? Because when I take y equal to x, if I move along the line y equal to x, then what happens? This is going to be x squared by x squared plus x squared. That will be always half. At each of these points, the function is going to take value half. Therefore, the limit will be half. But that's not equal to the value of the function at 0, 0, which is 0, 0, right? Limit, okay, x going to 0 along the line, x equal to y, half f of x, x, okay, is equal to half. But that's not equal to f of 0, 0. Therefore, f is not continuous, okay? But it should also be, but you know, this is a proof. I gave a counter example. Usually teachers are happy with this. Okay. But you should try to understand what goes wrong here. Notice that if I want to say the partial derivative of a function exists at the point A comma B, I am looking at the behavior of the function F only along this line and again only along this line. Right. This is y equal to B. This is x equal to a. Okay. To compute the partial derivative with respect to x, I have to look at only this and this. But whereas continuity, you know, it requires the value of the function in and around the point a, b. There are therefore a lot of directions are there. I have no idea about that. So something can go wrong. Do you understand this? It's a vague thing, but you should have this kind of feeling. Okay? How many of you understood what I said? Partial derivative looks at only the behavior of the function along these two lines, whereas continuity deals with the value of the function in and around the point AB. If you know the word, an open disk or a neighborhood or whatever you want to call it. Okay, that is the reason. And next, if those students in final year, third year BSc will ask, then what happens if directional derivative? Right, that we will attend to tomorrow. So, what are the things so far we have proved now? So we have proved that if the function is differentiable, it's continuous at that point, right? And we also saw why we insist the error should go to zero faster than this. And third, the converse, if the partial derivatives may exist, but the function may not even be continuous at the point AB, and hence it will not be differentiable at the point AB. Do all of you understand this? So these are the three results we have seen today. Next, what I want to do is I want to look at the geometric meaning of partial derivatives. But before I go further, let me ask a question whether you know this. It will make my life easy. Otherwise, I'll find a way out. Suppose I have something like a curve from an interval to, let us say, R3. Okay, this is a three-dimensional space, t going to, let us say, x of t, y of t, z of t. That is, it's a function f from this interval to R3. Therefore, f of t must be a vector or an ordered three to ordered triple. It depends on t, so I call it x of t, y of t, z of t. Then the tangent vector to this, or the velocity vector, in your physics, at least you must have learned this word. The velocity vector is given by this. Do you know this? How many of you know this? Please say yes. Very subdued response today. Okay. It's fine. Now let's look at some picture. Let me just say what I want to do the following. So my picture may not be very good, and it will be nice if you can. I hope all of you want to learn, okay? Don't give up so easily. See, what I want to do, we were drawn a picture like this earlier. This is the domain in the XY plane. This is the axis, and this is the graph. So any point here is xy, f of xy. Right? Now suppose this is the point A, comma B, right? Now let's look at this. Okay, this is the x direction, this is the y direction, therefore this is y equal to B line. And the next one will be x equal to A line. This will be y equal to b line, right? Now, as I move along at each point, if I look at, I have a graph. This is my x, where is b? Therefore, I'll have a point here. You understand this? No, I don't want a line. It looks very strange. Yeah, this is good enough. Okay, I will remove that also. Okay, no. Okay, this is the line. Whereas this, are you following what I mean? This is x comma b, this is x comma b, f of x comma b. And similarly, this will be like this. Okay, take any point here. Any point here will look like what? A, y, and the image will be a, y, f of a, y. Do you understand? So these are the two curves here, which lie on the graph. Therefore, I can talk about the tangent vectors of this. So I will draw the picture completely separately. This is one, this is another. Okay, this is lying on the graph. Okay, this is the tangent vector, and similarly, this is a tangent vector. It depends upon the way I move. Okay, it's all right. These are the two one. What I want to claim is this tangent, the slope of this tangent vector is your dou f by dou x, and this will be dou f by dou y. Okay, it will be nice if we can show some picture. So let me just share some picture which I have prepared. Are you following what I'm trying to say? We'll go slow. Oh, I had already prepared. Okay, great. I didn't know that. Are you able to see this? Shweta?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now you see that? This is, I took a magnification, so it looks a little odd.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now this is the function. Okay, this is the unit disk in R2. That is x squared plus y squared less than 1. And what is the function? The function is xy going to f of xy equal to root of 1 minus x squared minus y squared. Okay. Therefore, at the point xy, I have to go exactly to the, in the graph where it would lie, it will be xy, and this will be f of xy height. That is root of 1 minus x squared minus y squared. Now, notice that is your z. Therefore, z squared will be 1 minus x squared minus y squared. Therefore, x squared plus y squared plus 1 minus x squared minus y squared will be 1. Therefore, this is nothing other than the sphere in R3 with the center at origin, radius 1. How many of you follow what I'm saying? Otherwise, I have to come back and write on the board. Are you able to follow me? My f of xy is root of 1 minus x squared minus y squared. Therefore, at the point xy, I have to go at the distance this. Okay, this will be the point xy comma f of xy. That is root 1 minus x squared minus y squared. But that is your z coordinate. But you can see as obvious thing, x squared plus y squared plus z squared is 1. That is the equation for a sphere with the origin at the center and radius 1. Okay, so now this is the point xy. So I move along this point here. This point, I'll go here. This point, I'll go here. Notice that when I'm here, x squared plus y squared equal to 1, because this is the boundary, this circle. X squared plus y squared is 1, therefore what will be the point? This point. 1 minus x squared minus y squared, therefore it will be 0. That means, okay, this will be this point, circle itself. Okay, keep this picture in mind. I'll come back to my board and explain. So, this is the disk, x squared plus y squared equal to 1. So, as I get to this point xy, which is here, anywhere, anything, it need not be 1, 0, it may be any point. Okay, then 1 minus x squared minus y squared will be 0. Therefore, the picture will look like the upper dome, okay, have an open bar. A ball, which is a sphere, and this is what we are, the only the upper hemisphere, this is the half the dome, is what we are going to, what we saw in that picture. Do you follow that? So what we showed was, you take any xy here, then in the picture on the dome, it looks like this. Okay, this point xy is here, and as I move along here. So when xy goes to 0, 0, then this is going to go to 1, therefore xy is 0, 0, therefore I am going to hit the north pole. That will be 1, 0, 0. Okay, because many people have problem with understanding geometry. So I'm sure many of you will be struggling, but try. Okay. So this is what happens. So far, what we are saying is, therefore at any point, when you say the partial derivative, this is the curve. This curve is what you call an atlas longitude. You must have heard longitudes and latitude. Okay. we are studying atlas geography. Okay, this is the latitude longitude circle. Mathematician call it a great circle. Okay, so that great circles are this, from North Pole to South Pole, connected through this kind of thing, there will be the thing. These are the great circles. Okay, this is enough, just have this idea. So I will show another picture. Are you able to see this?
Not yet, sir.
Oh, I have not yet shared it. Okay, okay. Yeah. Now, do you see that? So, let us assume I am moving along XY. I would like to have some other thing. Oh. Anyway, let me all write. Okay. So, this is the graph of a function z equal to f of XY. So, I am fixing a point, let us say, B, and then I am looking at f of xb. Therefore, as x along, okay, this is my maybe my x coordinate. As I move along, I am cutting this, and therefore this will be the plane y equal to b. So you have, do you see that? This is the surface. This is y equal to b plane. When it cuts along the curve. So this may be your point AB. Therefore, for this curve in the plane, this curve lies on the plane. You understand? Therefore, I can talk about the tangent vector at this point. That tangent vector is nothing other than del f by del x. Now, do you see this? Yeah. Now, as I move along here, I get this blue curve, and as I move along this way, another coordinate thing, I am going the red curve, right? Okay. This is the tangent vector to the red curve. This is the tangent vector to the tangent line to the blue curve. Okay. And this will be the slope. Slope of the tangent is what we are going to get, del f by del x, del f by del y. And you should not simply try to follow me blindly. Okay. You should see that this is what you did in your one variable calculus. What did you do one variable calculus? You had a function from f of ab to r. Then look at the graph, which is a function r2. Then any point here is x comma fx. Right. Therefore, looked at the tangent to this curve. That will be 1 comma f dash of x. So this f dash, therefore the slope is f dash of x by 1. So that is why you call this the slope of the tangent. That's what I am doing there also. Okay, please spend some time. I will be forwarding this to you, the transcript. Have a look at and don't do that. So this is the geometric meaning of this thing. So the question you should ask now is, go back to the theory which we did. The partial derivatives exist, and therefore the tangent line through the point AB, okay, to the x curve, that is x going to f of xb exist, and similarly the tangent line to the curve y going to f of ay also exists. Therefore I got a two tangent line. Therefore I get some plane, but that plane may not be the tangent plane, because if I want to say it's a tangent plane, I need an extra condition. Okay, it should approximate the distance between the corresponding point of the tangent plane and the surface, graph surface, xy comma f of xy, that is z equal to f of xy, they should be very close to each other. Okay, that is our epsilon delta condition. Okay, please pay attention. How many of you at least vaguely understood what I am trying to say? Please tell me. Very good.
Okay. Sir, it is little bit flickering.
It's a flickering, right? Okay, because there are too many things open, and I'll close them now. I don't need any of them. Whenever there is something open, it tries to flicker. Because Zoom get confused what it has to share. Okay. Okay. So now I hope you have some reasonable idea. After that, what you should do is you should do calculus. This is conceptual ideas about differentiation. What is meant by differentiability? What is meant by partial derivatives? What is the geometric meaning? What is their physical meaning? Which implies which? Differentiability implies existence of partial derivatives. The converse may not be true, etc. Okay, and differentiability implies continuity. Okay, and differentiability, now we are interpreted in very many ways. F is differentiable at a, b implies f is approximable by a first degree polynomial of the correct kind. And second thing is that there is a tangent plane at the point a comma b comma f of a b to the graph surface z equal to f of x y. And when I say there is a tangent line, there is an additional condition. In each of the cases, there we are making an error, and epsilon delta gives a quantitative way of controlling the error. But qualitatively, okay, we are approximating the first case. In the second case, we are approximating geometrically the surface by a plane. Good. But there is a positive result, which we don't need a proof of that, but I will just say that. The positive result is, suppose f from u this, okay, has partial derivatives at a, b, and assume the it's continuous. That is, dou f by dou x at a, b, and dou f by dou at a, b are continuous. Then f is differentiable. You understand that mere existence of partial derivatives is not enough to conclude f is differentiable at a, b. But if I know the partial derivatives exist and are continuous, then I know it's a differentiable. So most often hereafter, what you do in your calculus course is you just check the partial derivatives, and by looking at, you know whether it's going to be continuous or not continuous. If it's continuous, then you conclude the function is differentiable. That's it, as simple as that. Okay, now the next thing is we want to interpret the notion of derivative in a third, again a geometric way. It's actually a physical thing, but let me say, let us go back to the plane. Suppose I have ax plus by plus cz equal to d or 0 or whatever. Okay, since it's a plane, then this a, b, c, not all of them are zero. If you know vectors, this means it's not a zero vector. At least one of the a, b, c is non-zero, right? And I think I already explained what is the meaning of a, b, c, geometric meaning of what is the geometric relation between a, b, c and the plane. Can somebody tell me what is the relation between this and this vector a, b, c?
Normal.
Exactly, it's normal, right? So it's normal to the plane, right? Okay, now come back. What we have done, so when I say f is differentiable at a, b, I said there is alpha and beta, but I know what is alpha. Alpha is del f by del x at a, b. Let me say, suppress a, b, okay, so that my writing will be easier. Beta, this is beta, not p, right? Then what is the equation of the plane? Z equal to alpha times x minus a plus beta times y minus b. Therefore, this is alpha x minus a plus beta y minus b minus z equal to 0, or z minus this is 0, right? Or may make it z minus, right? Therefore, this is minus here. Therefore, it's minus alpha, minus beta, and 1. This is your ABC. Do you understand that? The equation of the plane is z minus alpha times x minus a minus beta times y minus b is 0. Therefore, if I go back to this notation of ABC, then I would write minus alpha, minus beta, and 1. Okay, this is the normal. Do all of you understand this? Now I am going to ask a question. If you know the answer to that, I'll be glad. It's just a knowledge based. Okay, I'm not asking you to do that. Have you learned vector algebra? What is meant by vector product of two vectors in R3? Please say yes, those who know that. I have two vectors, x1, y1, z1, and x2. Maybe you know you will write it as x1i plus y1j or z1k, I believe, right? I write it only as x1, y1, z1. And similarly, x2, y2. Then you know what is the vector product or cross product of these two vectors. How many of you know that? Only 5? 6? I'm surprised. Yeah? Okay. The reason why I asked is, do you remember? Let us look at the curve x going to x comma b f of xb. Okay, this sits in the plane y equal to b in R3, because y coordinate is always in b. You understand that? Remember the picture which I showed you. There is a picture like this and a plane cutting along this. Okay, this is a curve. Okay, you understand this, right? Now I also said, what is the tangent vector at this 1 0, and this is del f by del x at the point AB. I'll just suppress this. And similarly, the other one is 0 1 del f by, sorry, yeah, the other one will be y going to a y f of a y. Therefore, it will be this. Right, and if you take the cross product, the vector product of that, you will get this. This is minus del f by del x minus del f by del y and 1. And again, your vector algebra would have told you the vector or cross product of two vectors is perpendicular to the plane spanned by these two vectors. Okay, notice that this vector span, the plane spanned by these vectors is tangent plane, right? And therefore, the cross product should be normal to the tangent plane. That's what we saw already. I hope you appreciate. These are the things which usually we don't see, because we have to finish the syllabus. We don't spend time. How many of you understand this? Again, about 30 to 40% is good enough for me. I'm just curious. See, throughout today, only about 17 odd students are responding. Do all of them belong to fifth semester? Please remove your yes and say yes to my question. Those 17 who had been answering, if you are fifth semester students, please say yes. I'm just curious, that's it. Maybe you are a third semester students. Very good. Okay, good. That means third semester students are answering, because only 2 students said they are fifth semester students. Okay. So given a function f from u from R2 to R, see, these are all tukde tukde results, not gang. Okay, you can see there are just too many small observations I am making. Okay, that makes things very interesting, because any building is built out of bricks, and any ocean is built out of drops, and any subject is also built out of small facts. They constitute a monomon. Okay, so we want to say this vector del f by del x and del f by del y, okay, this is at the point, this is what you call gradient. This is the definition. This is called a gradient of f at the point AB, if you write at the point AB. Okay. Next 5 to 10 minutes, I want to explain two results about the gradient. Okay. The first thing is, suppose f admits partial derivatives there, okay, with respect to x and y, then you may think I can form the gradient. You understand what I mean? Yes, because how do I define the gradient? By del f by del x, del f by del y, right? Okay. Maybe you have seen it in this notation. I detest this notation, but anyway, if you are comfortable with that, I will write it this way. Is that okay? This is a vector. Okay, for me, this is also a vector, except I know this, so I don't write too much. This is a much better notation for me. You understand this? This vector is called the gradient vector. Okay, now what is its importance? The importance is very easy. See, suppose I have u and take a point AB, right? Now there are many directions, okay, through AB. You understand? Now what I can ask is, I am here, I want to know what is the direction in which my function increases fastest. You understand that? Yep, increases fastest on which direction? Remember Newton's method? When he said f dash of x, what he said? It's a rate of change. Okay, we may call it a velocity in terms of physics. So it's a rate of change. So he want to know what is the rate of change in certain direction. Perhaps f moves faster in this direction. Okay, so what this says is, at the point AB, look at del f by del x at AB. This is the gradient. If you want, again at I plus del f by del y at AB, J. Okay, this is the direction in which the function f, okay, increases fast. To make you understand, I'll again share the picture which I showed you of the sphere case. I have to open it again. Okay, are you able to view this picture? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, okay, good. Now, this is your ground. Assume this, as I said, this is a sphere, part of the sphere, right? Now, this is the North Pole, as I said, right? Because this is f of xy is root of 1 minus x squared minus y squared. Therefore, this, okay, at 0, 0, it will be 0, 0, 1. The point above that will be North Pole, right? Now suppose I am kind of Eskimo here, okay, or perhaps who is it? Those people who climbed the Everest, Hillary, right? Okay, suppose he wants to climb the fastest way to reach the North Pole. What is the best way he can do? The best way he can do, yes, look at his position xy direction here. This is xy, right? Now, what he should do is he has to go through the gradient direction. Now, notice that we saw this is the gradient. Okay, this is the curve. The gradient direction is this. Okay, so if he wants to reach North Pole fastest, then he has to go along this, which is the great line. What I, as I said, it's a great circle. It's a longitude of the Earth. Or in other words, suppose you are an adventurous guy. You want to, you are at the North Pole. You want to reach this point by skiing. You want to reach fastest. Then you have, what direction you will do? You will again go in this direction, the gradient direction. Okay. So that is why called, when I want to come this way, I'll call it steepest descent. When from here, if I want to go here, it will be steepest ascent. Okay. This is very useful for real life problems. Okay. So if I want to have some quantity, as I said, let's say production. Okay. It's a function of various, very many variables, X, Y, Z. And the production cost F of X, Y, Z. Then I want to reduce the production cost. Let us say F of X, Y, Z is a profit. I want to increase the profit. Okay. Given the same ingredient X, Y, Z, then what is the fastest way I can do it? Okay. And stock market, all those things. Okay. It's a very useful concept. Yeah. In all real life problems, this is one of the most important. When you learn optimization theory, etc., you learn this. Let me ask you a question. How many of you climbed to reach a mandir? You had to climb something like 100 and 200 steps. Have you done that ever? Can you imagine that? Yeah. Now suppose it's like this. I climb like this. This is the fastest way I can reach the top, but it's the steepest also. If you try to climb the steepest way, your heart and lungs will pound. Okay. So you, if you see how people will climb, they reduce. It's a longer route. It won't reach you faster, but then it's a less load on your body. But if you want, if you are highly athletic, then if you want to reach fastest to show that, okay, you are a masochist, then you can reach like this. That's the steepest ascent. So the gradient direction gives you the steepest ascent or descent, depending upon whether you want to come down or you want to go up. That is the reason why gradient is important. Okay. And again, as I said, there is another method, reason. This is the physical reason, optimization problem. And just before I stop this today's lecture, there is also another reason for that. It also gives a normal to the, okay, level set. What do I mean by level set? I will explain in a minute. Okay, let F be a function from, let us say, R3 to R. If you want, you can take R2 to R also. Okay. But here it makes much more easier. Let us look at the simplest function, F of X, Y, Z equal to Z. That is a Z coordinate. All right. Now, I want to know, this is called the level set. Okay. What is the level set? This is Z equal to Z, Z plane. You understand that? That's a plane. So, I mean, it should be parallel to this XY axis. This is a plane. So, this is called the level set. Right? So, that looks like a surface. Okay? Then, what do I want to know is, what is the normal to that at that point? It's, if it is a surface, then there is a tangent plane. Let's assume, here it's already a plane. Then I want to ask, what is the normal to this? Do not lose heart. I am going to give a concrete example. Right? Let's look at the simplest case, F from R3 to R. Let's look at F of X, Y, Z equal to X squared plus Y squared plus Z squared. Then let's look at F equal to 1.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Lot of flickering is happening, sir, on your screen.
Yeah, right. Because that's open, no? Yeah, thank you. Right. Is it okay now? Better?
Yes, sir. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So, this is set up points x, y, z as that f equal to 1. That means x squared plus y squared plus z squared equal to 1. As I had already explained, that is the sphere of radius 1. All right. Now, what do I want? Start with the point here. These are on the surface of the sphere. Okay. Don't think of its interior. Think of the earth. You are on the surface of the earth. Okay. Right. This is the North Pole. This is the surface of the earth. If you come here, you will get a South Pole. Anyway, this is the point. Okay. Now, I know already a tangent plane exists. I want to know what is the normal. Again, if you have problem with R3, think of this R2 to R, the same function, similar function rather, x squared plus y squared. Right? Then f equal to 1 or f equal to some positive thing, this is nothing other than the circle of radius 1 at the origin. Now start with this point. This is the tangent line. What is the normal to this? Normal is the radial vector. All of you know that, right? Yes? This is the normal vector. That is what you call is, this is what we call the position vector, is already the normal vector to the circle. Similarly, I should expect on the surface of the earth, okay, please all of you imagine a ball, a round ball, and you are on the surface and you can put a plane on that, which is tangent plane, okay, just to touch us at that point. Now you can see the position vector, that is from the center of the ball to the point of contact, that will be normal to the plane. Do you understand this? I claim it is nothing other than the gradient. Let us see that. Because let us look at f of x, y, z equal to x squared plus y squared plus z squared. What is the gradient? At the point, this is 2 times, if you want, 2xi, 2 times xy, yj plus zk. I will write it as 2xy. Okay. So this is the normal, but if it is a normal, then any scalar multiple, right? This is the normal 2, but this is also a normal. So the position vector is a normal. So the gradient of a function, of a differentiable function, denotes 2 things. What are the 2 things it denotes? It says the direction in which the function has the fastest increase. And second, if you think of the level set, the gradient is nothing other than the normal vector to the tangent plane to the level set f equal to c. These are the 2 things. Okay, these are both are very, very important interpretations in real life. Okay, in all applications, of course, within mathematics, in geometry and topology. Okay, and just one more example, with that I will stop. Let us look at f from R3 to R, but then this is f of x, y, z is just x squared plus y squared alone, not z squared. Then f equal to 1, you see that x and y coordinates are bound by condition x squared plus y squared equal to 1, and z could be anything. Therefore, this will be stack of circles. Therefore, this is a cylinder. Right? F equal to 1 will be a cylinder. Now, if I take a cylinder, you can imagine, take a piece of paper, your notebook paper, and make it as a cylinder. Okay? Then you can see the tangent will be how it looks like. Okay? This will be the vertical line of one of the tangent, and this will be a plane which is tangent to that, and this position vector will be the normal. Okay? That is, this vector will be normal to that. What is that vector? Let us look at this. The gradient of this is going to be 2 times xi and plus yj in my notation and 0. That doesn't matter. If you want it at the same point. Okay, so this will be normal to this plane. Okay, these are some small, simple-minded examples to make you feel confident about the thing. So you can notice today we covered quite a bit of small things. Okay, So I will stop the lecture. If you have any questions, you can ask me.